I see a lot of new faces because of baby dedications today, so I just want to be the first one to say welcome. We are going to stand all together, and we're going to start this morning off with some singing, so join with us.
Across the earth, your praises rise. We lift our voice and call upon your name. You gave us hope that never ends. In Christ alone, the victory remains. Yeah. For you are great.
Yeah.
sing with me. Let every creature, heaven and earth below, bless his name, bless his name. Let every creature, heaven and earth below, bless his name, bless his name. Heaven and earth below, bless his name, bless his name. Oh, every creature, heaven and earth below, bless his name, bless his name. So come, let us sing for joy.
Welcome you guys to Crossroads Church this morning. We're so glad that you're here. Take a second, say hi to those around you, greet each other, and then go ahead and be seated.
Good morning, how are you? Good morning. Good morning. How are you?
Go ahead and have a seat. Today, this weekend, we celebrate the gift of new life as these parents are bringing their sons and their daughters before the church for dedication. And you know what the Bible teaches us? The Bible teaches us that children are God's possession, but God has entrusted us with their care and their nurture and to bring them up in the teaching of Jesus Christ. In fact, Jesus put children at such a level of importance, he called us to receive children in his name. And parents, as you come and bring your sons and daughters for dedication, and come on up. What you're promising before God and all of us is that you're going to do all you can with God's help to raise them in a Christian home. And if that's the case, say we will. Is it your desire that your sons and your daughters, when they become of age, that they would, when they make a decision, they would follow Jesus as their Lord and Savior? Well, because Jesus said, "Let the little children come unto me, for such belongs the kingdom of God." We'll start, where is Tucker? Tucker Body. Tucker Tyler Sexter? Tucker Tyler. I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. It's all over, buddy. You did good. Canyon Roberts. Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. Oh, baby. Thank you. Oh, there you go. Okay. This here is Julia Ray Sexter. Julia Ray, I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. There you are. Canyon Robert Sturgis, looking sharp, buddy. Canyon Robert, I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. we got here? Amelia Von Perotto. Amelia Von, I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Here we've got J.J. Benson. J.J. I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Alejandro Elijah Nunez. Alejandro Elijah. I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Pearl Beatrice Zickrick. Pearl Beatrice, I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Evelyn
Miles.
Miles Aleman? Aleman. Evelyn Miles, I present you to God the Father, Jesus Christ the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. You know, this parenting thing and what they're promising to do before God and all of us is not something that they're meant to do alone. And so I ask you, as family and friends and as part of the body of Christ here, would you stand with me? And let me ask all of you, will you do everything you can to encourage these little ones with the love and the grace of Jesus Christ? If so, say, we will. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for the gift of new life. And we thank you for each one of these boys and girls that's up here. God, we pray that they would grow wise and that they would grow whole. And I pray, God, that you would guide them safely through the dangers of childhood. You would preserve them from the temptations of youth and this world. And I pray at an early age, every one of them would give their life to you and follow you as their Lord and Savior. And God, we pray for the parents here. Free them from anxiety. Give them massive amounts of patience and love. Give them confidence and free them from the anxiety of being parents. And help them to know that we are there for them as family, as friends, and as a church. And I pray that they would know that they can love with your love. They can teach your truth, and they can be vessels of your grace in their sons' and daughters' lives. And God, we present these kids and these parents to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's encourage them once more as they go on.
Of monsters like everybody is.
right beside you, closer than a kiss, safe and sound. So that heaven's love can reach every single day. So baby, close your eyes now, say a prayer with me. Lord, lay me down to sleep now, but I know I will be safe and sound. You're here with us now, will always be safe and sound. You're here with us now, and that's all we'll ever, all we'll ever. That's all we'll ever.
Well, I want to welcome you to Crossroads. Good seeing everybody here this morning, meeting some new people in the atrium today, and just wonderful to see everyone, give you the official Crossroads welcome. And I've got four announcements, so you can sit back and count these, but take these in. And the first one is this. You know, last weekend we announced that we were going to go to a Sunday-only format beginning next week, that we were going to end our Saturday night service. And I was part of that decision, big part of that decision. But I have to tell you, I hated making that decision right from the beginning, and it bothered me all last weekend. And then this week, I got a lot of feedback from people, a lot of emails, phone calls. Just about everybody I ran into made a comment about it. And many of the people were people for whom Saturday night was their service, or that's when they could come to church, or other people that they like the option of being able to come to Crossroads on a Saturday night. And other people that just liked it, that we had those different options for people. And I agreed with every single person. I want to say thank you for the feedback, the comments, all of that. And in light of that, we're going to continue Saturday night. We're going to keep it going. Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a good decision. I'm excited about the decision. We started Saturday night, just so you know, 12 years ago. We were in schools doing Saturday night. I read 1 in 5 people can't go to church on a Sunday. And we started Saturday, and so we're going to continue Saturdays. And so get the word out. We had a big one last night. They actually stood, many of them, and applauded when that announcement was made. But that's their service for many of them, and it is for many of you also. But get the word out, Facebook it, tweet it, Instagram it, do the old-fashioned talk to somebody and tell them Saturday is on. And I feel great about that. And I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your feedback, and thank you for your patience. Patience and support for all of us that are in leadership here and trying to lead, you know, in a way that honors God. So thank you for the feedback. And Saturday's on. Yeah, good, good. Second announcement. Next Sunday, we're having our membership class. I lead this time, and it's from 12:30 to 3, lunch included. Give you the history, the values, why we do what we do around here at Crossroads. You've never been through membership? Come next Sunday, come to this service, hang around. Lunch is served. You can register online or maybe out at Information Central or Next Step area. They can tell you how you can be registered. And I challenge everybody to consider that if you haven't signed on for Crossroads. Third announcement is on June 22nd and 23rd, we're having baptism services, Saturday and Sunday. Anyone who wants to be baptized, as many as want to, on Saturday and Sunday, 23rd of June, Dennis Anderson will have a short informational meeting down front after this service, and you can get more information about how you can be part of baptism, June 22nd, 23rd. My last announcement is a series I'm starting next week. There's this card in the program. 4 weeks, I'm going to do God at the Movies. We're going to take an Academy Award-winning movie every week. I'm going to walk through the movie. We're going to show clips. And we're going to look at spiritual truths that are in movies that we love. Sometimes we think spiritual truths are only taught and only seen in here on a Saturday or a Sunday. That's not the case. Next week, I'm going to spend the whole message talking about the King's Speech. And you can watch that movie this week if you would like. But I'm going to walk us through it. We're going to look at quite a few clips. And I'll walk you through the movie if you've never seen it. But it's a movie about overcoming adversity, overcoming obstacles in life. It's a movie about failure, then facing that failure, facing our fears, and then through that, experiencing God's success for us in life. So next week, I'm going to look at The King's Speech. Week after that, classic Western, True Grit. Then on Baptism Week, we're going to look at Les Miserables. And then I'm going to end it all by looking at The Help, a movie that I loved. And so this is a great opportunity to invite people to Crossroads. Go, man, my church, they're doing God at the Movies. You love movies? Come hear what some of God's truth that is found in the movies that we all love. So that's the next 4 weeks. We're going to take our offering now, and this goes to all the work that we do here at Crossroads, and I just want to say thank you. I'm glad that we're in this work together. Let's bow our heads and let's pray together. God, we thank you for the church, your church, right here at Crossroads. God, lead and guide us. Make us closer followers of yours by being here today. God, people that impact this world, that's what we want to be all about. And use this offering to do that. Impact this world with your love and your grace and your mercy. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you, oh, I need you. Every hour I need you, my one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Oh, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Yeah.
how I need you.
How many of you are familiar with the whole series of movies called Star Trek? How many of you? Yeah, a lot of you are familiar. Oh, even some fans here today. Well, they just released the 11th Star Trek movie on May 16th. And I want to read the synopsis of that movie right off of the Star Trek website. When the crew of the Enterprise is called back to Earth, they find that an unstoppable force of terror from within their own It's not quite right. Something's missing. You guys got any music? When the crew of the Enterprise is called back to Earth, they find that an unstoppable force of terror from within their own organization has devastated the fleet and everything it stands for, leaving our world in a state of crisis. With a personal score to settle, Captain Kirk leads a manhunt into a war zone world to capture a one-man wrecking crew of mass destruction. As our heroes are propelled into an epic chess game of life and death, love will be challenged, friendships will be torn apart, and sacrifices must be made for the only family Kirk has left, his crew. There you go. Anybody see that movie? What's it called? Into Darkness. And if you think about the plot of that movie, you realize, whoa, that plot sounds unbelievably familiar, right? The earth is in a mess from an evil force. A savior has to put together a little group of people to come right into this war zone to defeat the power of evil, right? And in this movie, to do what? Establish peace on earth forever and ever. Or in Star Trek's case, until Star Trek 12. But the plot of that movie, we're familiar with it. Because it's your story. It's this story. It's the story. And our lives line up with it. I mean, the phrases from that introduction. An epic chess game of life and death. Some of you know all about that this week. An ambulance was at your door. You had to dial 911. You have a business that's on life support, life and death. You got the test results. Love will be challenged. Oh, your love was challenged this week. Your marriage is hanging by a thread. Not sure you can go on. Your love is being challenged. Somebody hurt you. And you don't want justice. You want revenge. Friendships will be torn apart. You couldn't believe what that so-called friend did to you this week. Real friends don't do that, but they did. And for some of you this week, the darkness was so overwhelming that you were tempted to give into it, to just let the darkness win. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Because it's your life and it's mine. And Jesus is well aware of these realities, of the darkness and the light. In 1246, Jesus says, I've come into the darkness, into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. And darkness in Jesus' day meant corruption and corrosion, meant disintegration and despair. And then Jesus said, but I've got some good news. In John 8:12, let's read this together. Here's the good news. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but we'll have what? The light of life. And in this series, we've been asking the question, who do you think you are? And the section of the Bible that we're looking at today, Jesus gives us two "you are" statements. He uses two very common metaphors. Matthew 5:13-16, I'll read it. He says, first of all, you're the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in that house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. The first "you are" statement is, you are the salt of the earth. And that sounds very common to us, doesn't it? Everybody take out that salt packet you were handed when you came in. How many of you have a salt shaker on your table at home? Yeah, everybody has a salt shaker at home. And it's because it's such a common thing. In a restaurant, if they could choose only one condiment, what would it be? It's not ketchup, it's salt. I brought my salt shaker from my kitchen table at home. Some of you actually were a little ambivalent about taking this salt because the doctor said low sodium or no sodium. And I grew up in a Swedish home, and we avoided salt because we thought it would actually make our food taste good. That's why we have this salt shaker now. But what's the number one use of salt in our country? We use it to put on our roads. That's the number. 51% of the salt is used on roads. Only 8% of salt is actually used for table salt. And in Jesus' day, there were two qualities of salt that were invaluable to them. And here's the first quality. Salt preserves things. Now, they didn't have refrigeration. And people discovered that if they could mine this white stuff out of the earth and they could rub it into food, it would keep it from going bad. It would keep it from decaying and rotting. It was almost like magic. And in fact, for them without refrigeration, for them to be able to store food for times of famine actually was a life and death proposition for them. Salt was very valuable. In fact, the ancients, many of the Italian cities, including Rome, were built on salt works. They used salt to pay their soldiers. The Latin word for salt is sal, which is where we get our word salary from. We say people are worth their... That's why we say that. In fact, a guy who wrote a book called Salt, The World History, Mark Kulansky, writes this. This book was on the New York Times bestseller list. In the ancient world, salt was one of the most common factors that provoked and financed wars. I mean, imagine. People go to war over salt. In fact, that's why when we say one country attacks another one, we call it they were assaulted. I made that up. You can't understand what Jesus is saying here unless you understand that in the ancient world, salt was a very prized element. Plato said that salt was dear to the gods, and Homer said it was a divine substance. It was like currency. It was like money. They went to war over it. Empires were built on salt. And so when Jesus says to this motley little undistinguished group of people that you, in fact, are God's plan to arrest the corruption and corrosion and overcome the decay and purify the world and actually add zest and flavor, they were shocked. Us? Salt goes, yeah, Jesus, you want to know who you are? You are salt. He says, if you're gonna associate yourself with me, then this is what you do. And the world needs salt. Wouldn't you agree? The world is going bad. It is. I mean, I'll just illustrate that. Your backyard. You just let it go this summer. Don't do anything. What's going to look like by the end of the summer? You know, it looks like John's yard right now, actually. Yeah. Your body. What if you, over the years you just let it go? You don't exercise, eat well. I mean, somebody said that men actually, as they get older, get furniture disease. Their chest falls into their drawers. That's what happens. Relationships. You just let your marriage drift. Don't do anything. What's going to happen to it? Race relationships. If we don't work at them, they fall apart. Emotionally, no one is naturally happy. You know, our tendency is, as for the human spirit, is towards depression and discouragement and despair. Even science knows that our physical universe, the earth itself, the sun, and all of our solar system is not getting better, it's getting worse. The sun is slowly burning out. And if you're a pure scientist and you don't believe in God, what that means for the entire human experiment is that we're just a short episode between two oblivions. Nobody's going to be here to remember we ever existed. And unless there's a divine, a supernature, a supernatural intervention, that's just the direction our lives are going. It's just a fact. And one more thing, if you don't allow for a supernatural involvement in our life here, well, then there's no basis for justice, good and evil, beauty, love, all of that, even meaning in life. And if you live and don't believe in God or a supernatural input into this life, and you still believe in those things, actually, you have to admit, what you're doing is you're eating off the Christian table, because that's where those things come from, meaning and life and love and all of that. And so salt keeps the world from going bad, because left to their own, that's where they go. And our world needs salt. And Jesus says, you're it, you're the salt, as a preservative, just to keep the world from going bad. And the second thing he says is salt seasons things. Salt brings out the natural and undiscovered gifts and flavors in food. Things taste, there's more joy in the world, right? Salt on corn of the cob, more joy. Salt on popcorn, more joy, right? Yeah, that's the way it is. But here's the sobering news about salt, is it doesn't exist for its own sake. Salt has to give up itself in order to accomplish that. I mean, how many of you, after you've had a great dinner at a friend's house, say, my, that was the best salt I've ever eaten? What kind of salt are you using? Honey, we have to get some of that salt. No, salt doesn't exist. It's to bring out the flavor of everything else. Salt's purpose is to lose itself in something more glorious than itself. And that's how it fulfills its destiny. And when it does that, it brings great joy. Philip Yancey wrote a story about a prisoner of war during World War II named Ernest Gordon. And he was a prisoner in a war camp that was, and their purpose was to build a railroad to the jungles of Thailand. And if you've ever seen the movie Bridge Over River Kwai, it's based on this story. And they were unbelievably brutal circumstances, conditions in this prisoner of war camp. They were forced to work in 120 degree heat, work with bare feet, which were often cut, diseased, ravaged by insects. And if you ever were slacking off, a guard would immediately decapitate you or beat you to death on the spot in sight of all the other prisoners. And if you got sick, they had a special spot for you, a little shack they called the Death House, where they put you in this little hothouse where you would literally roast to death. And through the course of the World War II, 80,000 men lost their lives building that railroad, 393 corpses per mile. And the prisoners themselves became animals. The only way they survived was on hate. The strong would beat up the weak for a few grains of rice, until one day, one man changed it all. At the end of the day, the work detail was winding up, and they counted the shovels, and one was missing. And the guards asked, who stole the shovel? Nobody admitted it. Finally, the guards were about to mow down the whole line of prisoners, and one prisoner stepped forward and said, I did it. I stole the shovel. And the guard immediately took the butt of his rifle and crushed the man's skull dead, and then just kept beating him and beating him. And later in the afternoon, they did a inventory of the shovels, and guess what? There wasn't a shovel missing. And that night, as the prisoners were reflecting about the day's event, they thought about that one man who stepped forward. And somebody remembered this Bible verse out of John 13, and he quoted it. He said, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And because of that one man's saltiness in that POW camp, it began to change things. They began to hold funerals for the prisoners that died. They began to put a cross on the graves. The strong would share their food with the weak. And they even began a little church there. And Ernest Gordon had been paralyzed by a high fever, and he'd actually been put in the death shack and written his last letter to his parents. And the other prisoners came, and they got him out of that death shack, and they brought him, and they nursed him back to health. And he became the ex officio pastor of this little church that began in this POW camp. Right in the midst of all that dying, all that death, this little life station springs up. And they even started a university, which they called Jungle University, where they taught philosophy and science and history in 9 different languages. And this little culture of life grew within this shroud of death. And Jesus had a word for that little culture. He called it the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God can sprout up in the most unlikely places. And in fact, when the liberating soldiers came in and brought freedom to this entire POW camp, the soldiers, the prisoners, treated the guards with mercy and respect and forgiveness. All because one man at one time stepped forward and said, I'll be salt in a very dark place. I'll lose myself. And he did. You know, Crossroads, we're not just here to hold services on a weekend. During the week, have classes and meet in our life groups and our Bible studies. No, Jesus said, you're the salt in a dark world. And you don't have to look very far in your world to find some darkness. It's everywhere, isn't it? It's all around us. It's even in us sometimes. And Jesus says, though, that salt can lose its effectiveness. That it's not, at some point, it's not good for stuff and can be thrown out. And it can get so corrupted with elements. There's 2 ways that salt loses effectiveness. First of all, it just stays in the shaker. And the second way salt loses its saltiness is it gets other, like sand added to it. And it doesn't take much sand where you wouldn't want to put it on your food. And Jesus says that's the way it is with salt. Sometimes it loses its effectiveness. And so the question is, are you a difference maker? Or if you're salt, are you staying in a salt shaker? Or have you been so influenced by some of the world's values that the value, your impact is being diminished by some of those things? So if you're going to be salt in your neighborhood, have you thought about that? How can I be salt in my neighborhood right where I live? I mean, do you know your neighbors? Do they know you? Do you go to the neighborhood parties? Do you throw the neighborhood parties? Or at work? You know, do you show up on a weekend or on a weekday and when you go to work and go, I'm going to bring out the flavor of this place? Or there's some darkness over here. I need to do something about that darkness that's over there. Or maybe there's so much darkness in your place of work that all you can do is bring a little salt in your cubicle, in your classroom, in the cab of your truck. You could be salt there. Or in conversations. Maybe you could be salt in a conversation. That'd be another way to be salt. B.C. Forbes said, the legendary founder of Forbes magazine said this. He said, it's better to be a first-rate truck driver than a 10th-rate executive. And so are we salt in with the people that we travel and live and work among? A few weeks ago, I was on a plane to fly to Oregon. And it was a very, very early flight. And so I had to set my alarm 2:30 in the morning and get up. And so when I finally got on the plane, I prayed to God, God, I just want to sleep. Please do not sit me beside somebody who wants to talk. And God answered my prayer. He said, not on your life. So he sat me next to this very talkative woman. You know, I want to go to sleep. Lord, do something about this. She told me in the course of our couple-hour flight, she said, you know, I'm a nurse. You know, we just carrying on small talk. Where are you going? Well, I was coming back from spending the weekend with my boyfriend who's in the military. And she mentioned the fact that she had been in Afghanistan for a year as a nurse, helping people over there. That the reason she was living in Portland and not with her boyfriend is because her aging parents really needed her help. And I asked her why she didn't have any kids, and she said, well, or she had kids, and she said, no, I'm kind of self-centered that way. I don't know that I could really want to bring kids into the world. And later in the conversation, I asked her if she was thinking about getting married, and then she said this the second time. She said, no, I'm not thinking about getting married right now because I'm too selfish. And the plane's about to land, and, you know, there comes a point in a conversation and relationship where you've earned some relational integrity, some relational credibility. And you have this kind of ability to speak into someone's life. And so we're, you know, battening up the plane to get ready to land. And I just turned to her and I said, you know, two times in our conversation, you said that you were selfish. I said, I don't know you very well, but I don't think you are. You, first of all, you're a nurse. You wouldn't become a nurse if you didn't care about people. You spent a year in Afghanistan caring for people who don't have access to good health care, and the only reason you're in Portland is to help your aging parents. I said, I don't think you're selfish at all. And she was just kind of sat there. And I sensed that something in her soul just shifted. And that there was a light that was turned on that she really hadn't given much thought to. A little bit of salt in a conversation, or a little bit of salt at work, a little bit of salt in a classroom, in a relationship, can make a big difference. So Jesus says that's what you're to do. You're salt. A little bit can make a big difference. That's who you are. That's the first thing. Then Jesus goes on, he switches the metaphor, and he says, you're the light of the world. And if being salt staggered them, the thought that they were the light of the entire world actually shell-shocked them. I mean, really, Jesus? We here in this little old Palestine are the light of the world? No way. And I want to bring out two aspects of light that they needed to understand, that we do too. The first is that the power of light is always greater than the power of the darkness. Darkness will not win. That's what Jesus says in Matthew 5:15. He says, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand so it what? It gives light to everyone in the house. Yes, you can limit the impact of light by putting something over it. But the single flame of light, Jesus says, can drive out the darkness of an entire room. So let me demonstrate that. Turn off the lights. How many of you can see this? I clap. I can't see your hands. Yeah, look at this. This room is entirely filled with darkness, right? It is. One single little light. Darkness cannot overpower it. You all could see it. The wind can overpower it, but the darkness can't. Anyway, turn the lights back on. And that's what Jesus is saying. Darkness has no power over light. And that's why Jesus says that the problem is not with the light. The problem is with the darkness. In John 3:19, Jesus says, light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. The problem is we love the darkness. Because when our lives come into the light, everything's exposed, isn't it? The good, the talents, the gifts, the flaws, the lies, the addictions, it's all exposed in life. Light is not very discerning in that matter. And sometimes we just rather not see those things ourselves, and we really don't want other people to see them either. Sometimes we'd rather stay in the darkness. But Jesus demonstrated on a cross 2,000 years ago that darkness has no power in this world anymore. It doesn't have to. Right? On that cross, the demonic forces of the world fought that they'd extinguished the light of God once and for all when Jesus died on that cross. Right? That's what they thought. And use your little imagination with me here. Imagine that Satan and all of his colleagues are throwing a big party in hell. And they're high-fiving each other, and they're toasting each other, and they're slapping each other's backs because they thought they'd got rid of the light of the world once and for all. And this party goes on for days. And about day three, Jesus strides into the party, right in the middle of their revelry, and he says, guess what? I played by your rules, and I win. Death has no power over me anymore. And that's why Jesus can say with resurrection truth, I am, that's what he says in John 8:12. He says, I am the light of the world. But he doesn't stop there. He says, whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And so I want to ask you, this is the first question when it comes to light. Because we don't light ourselves. Light comes into our lives from the outside. God comes into our lives from the outside. And so here's the question. Do you have the light of Christ in you? Or some of you might understand it better this way. Have you been lit? I'm talking about last night. I'm talking, have you been lit by Jesus himself? Have you? In John 12:36, Jesus says this, believe in the light while you have the light so that you may become what? Children of light. And maybe you've been acquainted with Jesus. Maybe you've been coming here for years or months. You're kind of kicking tires, checking it out. But you've never said to Jesus, I want to invite you fully into my mind, into my life, into my heart, into my decisions, into my intentions, into my future, into my past. I've never really asked you to bring your light to bear on all of that. You know, in the Bible, we call that coming to faith. We call that believing. We call that receiving Jesus. That's what that's called. And maybe you've never done that. You could do that today. You could do it now. In a minute, I'm going to pray, and you could do it then. And then Jesus says, once we have the light, he goes on to say, now you light up the world. You're the light of the world. A.W. Mills wanted to be a light in a very dark place. So he invested 30 years of his life in a little community of people who were committed to violence and death. And at the end of those 30 years, the community was transformed. And when he died, they put this on his tombstone. When he arrived, there was no light. When he died, there was no darkness. And I wonder, could that be said of us? Wouldn't you like that to be said of you? Wouldn't you like that to be said of you if you were in a neighborhood and you had to move, you moved to another part of town, your neighbors would say, you know what, that person brought joy and life to our neighborhood. We miss them. Or maybe you change jobs or you have to move to another city or you lose your job. Would your employees, would your employer, would your colleagues at work say, you know, I miss them. There was something about their life that just spice things up here. Would somebody say that about you? I'll bet you'd like people to say that about you. And then Jesus takes that one step further. He says, not only are we individually to light up our own little worlds. He says in 14 and 16, you're the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. And Jesus is saying, if a lamp can light up an entire room of a house, imagine what an entire community of people who have the light of Christ could do in a country or in a world. Imagine a city on a hill lit up. And that's the second point. Our light shines brighter when we shine together. We got to do this together. And let me demonstrate that. Everybody take out your cell phone. Yep, take it out right now. Turn it on. I know we tell you, turn it off, turn it on. If you have a flashlight app, turn it on. Another thing I want to point out, just turn it on right now. I'm going to have you do something with it in a second. Jesus points out, and this isn't clear in the English, but all the pronouns and all the verbs in this section are plural. He's saying, put your city on a hill. And so turn off the lights. Everybody hold up your cell phone. It's on. Look around the room. Turn your cell phone around and around so other people could see it. One flame is pretty good, right? Imagine a city on a hill. Think of the light we could bring to the world. You could turn the lights back on, guys. On August 29th, 2005, Hurricane Katrina came ashore in the Gulf Coast. It wreaked death and destruction for hundreds of square miles in the Gulf Coast. Devastated the place. 1,833 people died. Talk about a culture of death and destruction. And we heard about it up here. Everybody heard about it. And we thought, what could one little church in Loveland, Colorado do in the light of all that death and destruction? And so we put the word out. Who wants to be salt? Who wants to be light? Who wants to go to the Gulf Coast? 80 people signed up right away for the first trip. And we went down there and we established a little beachhead in Bay St. Louis. And over the next 3 years, 13 groups from Crossroads went to the Gulf Coast. 350 people said, I'm going to give a week and go down there and help. But God wasn't done. That was pretty cool, but God wasn't done. While we were there, a man from our church, we were talking one day, and he said, you know, Dennis, a lot of people cannot give a week of their life to come to the Gulf Coast and try to be salt and light. Not everybody can do that, he said, but everybody at Crossroads could give a day a year to be salt and light in Northern Colorado. And Project One was born. So on May 6th, 2006, we put out the call to Crossroads. Hey, who wants to be salt and light right here? We had 50 projects to do. 500 people signed up year one. After it was such a great experience, we said, let's do it again. Year two, it was 100 projects and 1,000 people signed up. And this last May, we did the 7th Project One. And if you're into statistics, here's what we've accomplished as a little church in Northern Colorado over 7 Project Ones. We've done 514 projects, 5,600 volunteers, 45,000 hours of volunteer labor valued at $675,000. Materials were worth $200,000 that were either purchased or donated were pumped in to Project One. And the people who served at Project One said, hey, we could do this more than once a year. So Project 12 was birthed. Saturday morning a month for people who go, hey, I want to be salt and light on a more regular basis. What can one person do with a little salt, with a little light, and an idea from God, and the ability to act on it, and put it before a community? Over $1 million worth of love and care and paint and sheetrock have been pumped in to Northern Colorado because one man on one day said, I'm going to be salt and I'm going to be light and I'm going to try to do it together with a church just like, well, not just like this, with this church. What can you do? Well, you can be salt and you can be light. And what happens in that verse when we do that? What happens? Do people rise up and praise us? No, it says that if we let our works shine, people will see those good works and what? Glorify God, be grateful to God because they've seen these good works. And there was a woman who wrote this after a Project One team had visited her house. She said, we have had a very tough year and there were times I didn't know how we could make it. Today made me realize that God does guide our journey and gives us hope and affirmation if we just look to him and not ourselves. And then she writes this, God has shown himself today. You know, one light is pretty good, but a city of lights, the community will look at that and go, only God. Only God. Let's pray. Lord, when you said to that little group of people, you're salt, you're light, you meant it. And you're saying the same things to us today as individuals and as a church. You're salt. This is your destiny. That's why I've put you in Northern Colorado. And Lord, there might be somebody here today who's never invited you to be the light, to come into their life and light it up. So Lord, I pray right now, this end of the service, that in their mind and in their heart, they would just say to you, and you could say this to God right now, Lord, I don't know everything about you. I don't have all my questions answered, but I want you to come into my life and bring light. Bring your light to bear on all it is that I am and have. And Lord, for all of us, you know, we don't want to be just space takers in this world. We don't want to be resume builders, money makers, business shapers. We want to be difference makers. And so God, we want to do that. Do that in us this week. Do it through us this week. We want to do that together. In Jesus' name, amen. couple reminders as you leave. If you're interested in getting baptized, just check out that little meeting with me right here. You can leave the kids. And if you're wondering, how do I get more involved at Crossroads? What's kind of the next step? There's an area out there called Next Step. Just stop and chat with one of those people there. And then next week, come back, bring your friends. What are we doing? God at the movies. All right. See you next weekend.